Welcome to Rice City Church. We are so glad that you are checking us out today. If this is your first time, we would love to hear from you and love to connect with you. If you want to text the word guest to 484848, it will send you a form. And once you fill out that form, if you are local to San Diego area, we will send you a coupon for some free Chick-fil-A. And once again, if you are new here, text guest to 484848. We are so glad that you're here this morning. Ladies, we would love for you guys to join us on October 15th through 17th up at Pine Valley Camp for our women's retreat this year. You guys, this is so much fun, and this is an opportunity for us to pull away from the normal day-to-day demands that we have and unplug for a couple days. So whether you're able to come up for the entire weekend or you're just able to come up for Saturday, we would love to have you. It's a chance for you to potentially meet new friends, but also to connect with those other friends on a deeper basis than maybe do on a normal Sunday morning or throughout the week. And it's also an opportunity to be intentional about putting yourself in a place where you can hear from God. Some of the most amazing moments in my walk with the Lord have been at retreats like this, where I'm able to pull away and just really put myself in a place to hear from Him. So we would love to have you join us. If you are interested in signing up, go to the website, www.ricecitychurch.com/events, or you can download the app and sign up on the app as well. Thank you so much for being such a generous church. We give because God is a giver Himself. And when we copy His behavior, we experience so many blessings because of that. So thank you for your generosity to Rice City Church. There are three ways that you can give. You can give on the app, on the website, or in person. So thank you so much again for being such a generous church. We appreciate that and are excited to continue to worship with you today.
The prison doors, he parted the Hey there, Rise City family. So glad you're joining with us again this week. And this week, we're landing the plane. This is the final episode or installment of our Shining in Babylon series. If you've been tracking along, I don't know if it feels like this to you, but it feels like it's flying by. Maybe that's because the last message series when we went through the book of John was like 10 months long. This is only 4 weeks long. But today is the final part of Shining in Babylon. And for those of you who maybe not have been a part of it up till now, let me give you a quick recap before we jump in today. We're looking at the life of a guy named Daniel. He's in the Old Testament. And when Daniel was a teenager, he and his friends and a lot of Jewish people, the Babylonian Empire came in, ransacked the city of Jerusalem, captured the teenagers, brought them back to Babylon to really indoctrinate and to help them try to become Babylonian people. Not worshiping the God of the Jews, but to now worship the God of the Babylonians and to live out the customs and the values of the Babylonians. Daniel had nothing to do with it, neither did his three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And what we've been looking at is four distinguishable qualities that these men possessed that helped them shine in Babylon. They didn't succumb to the pressure. They didn't capitulate and conform, but rather they impacted and were significant and they shined bright in Babylon. And so these four distinguishable qualities is what we are asking the Lord to really place upon our lives as we find ourselves living in a culture, we being those of you who follow Jesus. It seems like the cultural trend is moving away from the ways of Jesus more than saying we want to be a part of the way of Jesus. And so how can we shine in our environment today? Week one, we looked at the distinguishable quality of integrity. If you cut Daniel open, you're gonna see the same on the inside as you got on the outside. He was a pineapple. We need to be people of integrity. Week two, we looked at the virtue of wisdom. Applying God's ways and his best is like us being stars that shine bright in darkness. Pete did a great job talking about being a people marked with God's wisdom. And then last week, we looked at faithfulness, having this fidelity, this trust, and this loyalty to God no matter what. In our as usual moments, as well as our even if, when it feels like all hell's breaking loose, we will stay faithful to God because God is faithful to us. Which brings us to our last distinguishable quality today, and that is the quality of prayerfulness. Prayerfulness. And this isn't something that comes to mind when I think of what it looks like to shine bright is to be a person of prayer. But when you read the book of Daniel, like you just can't get away from seeing it just jump off the pages over and over again, that Daniel was way more comfortable like down here on his knees praying than he was like being a part of the administrative court for the different empires. He was a man of prayer. And I would argue that because he was so prayerful, it helped him be a man of integrity, have wisdom and faithfulness. And so that's what we're gonna look at. How can we, those of us who say we wanna follow Jesus or are followers of Jesus, how can we be marked with prayerfulness? And I don't know about you, but I need this one because for me, just to be honest and transparent for a moment, like prayer, it's kind of like my spiritual kryptonite. Like I pray every day, but I get distracted big time. And sometimes I'm like, was I just praying or when did I stop? And oh man, I'm working on my to-do list or I'm flipping through my phone or whatever. Like I much rather read the scriptures just because it keeps me focused. But Daniel was prayerful and dependent. And that's what I want to be. I hope that's what you want to be. And I think I know that's what we need to be if we want to shine in our own Babylon. So, Daniel chapter 9, that's where we're going to land. We have an entire prayer that Daniel prayed. He wrote it for us. He must have known, like, someone needs this, and we need it. So, Daniel 9 is a prayer that Daniel prays. And I want us to really look and to feel what he talks about, what he prays about, and just the way he just unleashes his heart to the Lord. And then really kind of dissect it a bit and see how we can apply it in our own prayer life as well. So, Daniel chapter 9. I'm going to read verses 1 through 19, so got a lot of verses. But I want to read these words, but I don't want to read them like, hey, we're just reading a passage in Scripture. This was a prayer that Daniel prayed. So I want to do my best to try to put some heart and emotion, and like if this was Daniel crying out, what would it have sounded like when he prayed to God like this? So the first couple verses are just a little context, and then we'll jump right into the prayer if you want to follow along. Says this, Daniel 9, chapter 1, it says, it was the first year in the reign of Darius the Mede, the son of Ahasuerus, who had become the king of the Babylonians. During the first year of his reign, I, Daniel's writing this. Daniel says, I, Daniel, learned from reading the word of the Lord as revealed to Jeremiah the prophet that Jerusalem must lie desolate for 70 years. And so I turned to the Lord God and I pleaded with him in prayer and fasting. And I also wore rough burlap and sprinkled myself with ashes. So this is just the notion of him physically and tangibly getting himself ready to pray to God. And then this is Daniel's prayer. It says, I prayed to the Lord my God and I confessed, O Lord, you are great and awesome. You are a great and awesome God. You always fulfill your covenant and you keep your promises of unfailing love to those who love you and obey your commands. But we have sinned and we've done wrong. We've rebelled against you and we've turned from your commands and your regulations and we've scorned them. We've refused to listen to your servants, the prophets, who spoke on your authority to our kings and princes and ancestors and to all the people of the land. Lord, you are in the right. And as you can see, our faces are covered with shame. This is true of all of us, including the people of Judah, Jerusalem, all of Israel, scattered near and far, wherever you have driven us because of our disloyalty to you. Oh Lord, we and our kings, princes, and ancestors, we are covered. We're covered with shame because we have sinned against you. But Lord, you, the Lord our God, you are merciful and forgiving. Even though we have rebelled against you, we have not obeyed the Lord our God. We have not followed the instructions that you gave us through your servants, the prophets, all of Israel, they've disobeyed and your instructions, and we've turned away, refusing to listen to your voice. And so now the solemn curses and the judgments that were written in the law of Moses, who was your servant, God, they've been poured down on us because of our sin. You've kept your word and you've done to us and to our rulers exactly what you warned. Never has there been such a disaster as what's happened in Jerusalem. Every curse written in the law of Moses, it's come true. And still, yet, we have refused to seek mercy from you, Lord, our God, by turning from our sin and recognizing your truth. Therefore, God, you've brought upon us this disaster that you prepared. The Lord, our God, was right. You were right, God, in doing all these things, for we did not obey you. Oh, Lord, our God, you brought lasting honor to your name by rescuing your people from Egypt in a great display of power. But we have sinned and we are full of wickedness. And in view of all your faithful mercies, Lord, would you please turn your furious anger away from your city, Jerusalem, from your holy mountain. All the neighboring nations mock us, mock Jerusalem, and mock your people because of our sins and the sins of our ancestors. Oh, God, would you hear your servant's prayer? Listen as I plead for your own sake, Lord. Please smile. Smile on your desolate sanctuary. Oh, my God, lean down and listen to me. Please open your eyes and see our despair. See how your city, the city that bears your name, it lies in ruins. We make this plea not because we deserve your help, but because of your mercy. Oh God, please hear us. Lord, please forgive. Oh Lord, listen and act for your own sake. Do not delay. Oh my God, for your people and for your city, we bear your name. Bear your name. Daniel's getting really raw in this moment. And this moment takes place somewhere when Daniel's in his mid-80s. We're told in the first couple verses that, you know, this is during the reign of King Darius. This is the same Darius that was reigning in Daniel 6 when he was thrown into the lion's den. Remember that last week? And so this likely took place just a year or two, maybe after Daniel had been spared from ferocious lions and not devoured, but now alive. And Daniel is now looking at God's word. So Daniel's not even a man of prayerfulness. I mean, he is a man of prayerfulness, but he's also a man of God's word. He's reading God's word and he's reading the prophet Jeremiah. And as he's reading the prophet Jeremiah, he comes upon some verses that likely just shook him to the core, because he sees that there is this place where Jeremiah, who was written 90 years prior to this moment, before Daniel was even probably born, this is crazy, like this is how God works, but it said that Jerusalem would lie desolate for 70 years. And all of a sudden, Daniel's probably started to do some math in his head, like, wait a minute, like, I came here probably, I don't know, around 600 BC, and it's about 539, 537 BC right now. It's almost been 70 years, and it says here that, like, it's going to lie desolate, but then God's going to do something. He's going to do something. So what's great is we know the clues that we're given here from Daniel, that this is the verse. We know that Daniel was reading Jeremiah 29. Check out what he would have been reading and tell me this wouldn't have blown your mind as well. It says this in Jeremiah 29, 10 through 14. It says, this is what the Lord says. You will be in Babylon for 70 years. Daniel's like, that's been about 70 years. He's talking to me right now. And says, God then says, but then I will come and do for you all the good things I've promised. And I'll bring you home again. To which Daniel's like, home? Like, I haven't been there since I was a teenager. It's almost the time. Like, I'm going to bring you home again. And this is a verse that many of you know, or you have it on your coffee cups, or it's your life verse, but it says, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. To which Daniel's just like, oh my gosh. And in those days, when you pray, I will listen. And I just picture that moment. Daniel's like in those days, like, it is those days. When you pray, oh my gosh. Like, he falls to his knees. And in that moment, he's like, I'm praying. I want to go home. God has promised me something. It says, in those days when you pray, I will listen. And if you look for me wholeheartedly, you will find me, and I will be found by you, says the Lord. And I will end your captivity and restore your fortunes. I will gather you out of the nations where I sent you, and I will bring you home again to your own land. Oh my goodness, can you imagine? Is it any wonder why Daniel fell to his knees and began to pray in chapter 9? And it's the prayer that I want to pay attention to, because there was a heart that Daniel had in that prayer when he knew who he was approaching. And he began to cry out, and he desperately wanted God's promises fulfilled in his life and the life of his people. So, how did Daniel go about praying? Well, the first thing that we see is that Daniel came to God with a proper awareness of who God is. That's huge. Daniel started by realizing who he was talking to. I think oftentimes when we seek to pray and ask God for whatever, we come asking at the very beginning. We don't even consider who we're talking to. We just say, this is what I want. This is what I need. Here's my problems. Can you provide? Can you protect? Can you give? Can you whatever? That's not where Daniel starts his prayer. He starts with an awareness of who he's talking to. In a similar fashion, Jesus, when he taught us how to pray, said, you should start your prayers with saying, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. You start with awareness of the God that you're actually talking to. And we get some clues of the nature of this God by what Daniel says in the first few verses. He starts by saying, oh, great and awesome God. That's a part of the vantage point of who God is. He is a great and awesome God. And that word awesome can also be translated great and dreadful God. It's not the way that we use the word awesome, like the Lego movie where everything is awesome, everything is great if you're part of the team. That's like the 21st century awesome. This is like scare the crap out of you awesome. Like, reverence, amazing. God created everything. In a moment, he can create, and in a moment, he can destroy everything. He is all powerful. He's all knowing. He's all present. He is great and awesome. That's where Daniel starts. And how could he not start there? I mean, he already knew that God was awesome. He delivered him from the devouring lions. He had lifted up his very people and let them go to captivity and exile for 70 years. This is a great and awesome God. But then he also talks about not just God being great and awesome, but he also says, you have been faithful in fulfilling your promise to those you love. He sees God, yes, as great and awesome, but he also sees him as faithful and loving. Because God has both parts. And we need to come to God with an awareness that He is great and awesome and He's faithful and loving. And when we come to God with just one and not both, or one at the expense of the other, I don't think we have the proper view of who we're talking to. You see, if we come to God just seeing God is awesome and dreadful and great and don't realize He's loving and faithful, which is kind of the more like warm, fuzzy, nice type, then we can come to God in trepidation and fear and think He's going to knock my head off. Like, I don't even, who am I to even approach Him? And there's a part of that we'll get to, like having a reverence. But if you don't realize that God is also faithful and compassionate and loving, you'll just come in fear and not even feel like you could approach Him. But the other side of it, if you only come to God as seeing Him as faithful and loving, this is where Jesus is my boyfriend and Jesus is my homeboy and warm fuzzies and what's up, Jesus? You're my friend. And we don't have a sense of awe. We miss that as well. But there's a both and. Great and awesome God who is faithful and loving that puts us in a position of seeing God as tremendous, even terrifying, but also approachable and unbelievably loving. In many ways, it's what I hope my kids see in me. You know, there's a part of me that's like, hey kids, I made you, and at least while you're this age, I can still take you out of this world. Like, I gave you breath to your lungs. I provide everything that you have. Like, you need me, right? There's the great and awesome. But I want my kids to come to me. I want my kids to know I'm approachable. I love you. I'm faithful. You can trust me. I'm always here for you. I'm good to my word. What I promise will be true. When you pray, how you see God really dictates how you approach Him. And we need both. And when we have both a great and awesome as well as faithful and loving, it puts us ultimately in a position, I believe, of weakness and dependence rather than one of strength and independence. Because we have an awareness that He is awesome, He is good, and I am the creation, He is the creator, right? So who am I to just quickly project, do this, do this, do this, do this for me? So I have that, but I also know that I can come to Him and share my heart with Him. And so it puts me in a place of weakness, of receptivity, of dependence, of saying, please, God, versus a place of power and strength, and you owe me, God. The Apostle Paul said it this way when he talked about in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 10, it says, for when I am weak, then I am strong. Daniel found his greatest position of strength on his knees in a weak position before the great and awesome, faithful, loving God. That would be very helpful for us to start with versus oftentimes the cavalier approach that we come just shuffling in and out. And no, He's great, awesome, faithful, and loving. And now I'm approaching God in a position of receptivity, in a place of saying, God, I'm listening versus God, you need to listen to me. So after Daniel has this moment of awareness, right, of a shaping up and seeing in reality who God is, it brings a shaping up and reality to seeing who He is as well. And it moves him to a point of confession. The middle parts of Daniel's prayer are just saturated with Daniel lamenting, feeling the pain, the guilt, the shame, and confessing to God what they've done wrong. He takes ownership of where the relationship got broken. And he comes to God asking and begging it to be fixed. Confession is something that needs to be a part of our prayer life. It's the acknowledgement that God, you are right. Remember, it said that here in the passage, God, you are right. And we are wrong. Like we're not in the right. And so we come to you to be made right. And I think oftentimes with confession is something in our own lives that we stay clear from. One, because I think the cultural trend, the greatest tragedy is if you feel negative emotions in today's world. And so when you confess and you acknowledge that you've done something wrong and you feel some guilt and shame, oh, that's negative emotions. And so you don't want to feel that. So you should never sit in that. But that's not the case. We need to be a people who honestly assess our own lives in light of what God's called us to live by. And when we miss the mark, we own it and we come to him. And this is what Daniel did. I love that we see Daniel confessing not just his own sins, but he also places himself in the same category of the sins of the whole nation. Now, what's interesting and even startling is, as I mentioned last week, you read the book of Daniel, you can't find a blemish on this dude's record. Like Daniel, there's not a sin that he committed that's actually recorded, but yet he's confessing sin. And he's also using the pronoun we, saying the sins that my people have committed, I'm a part of the problem as much as they are, I'm there. And we know the scriptures say all, not some, but all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And so Daniel has a realistic perspective of himself and his people and before their God. And he says, we need to confess where we've missed the mark. And I would say we need to do that too. But too frequently, we find ourselves minimizing our sin, trivializing our sin, blaming our sin, excusing it versus sitting in it, feeling the weight of it and saying, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. You know, I think of how my kids respond. I've got 4 kids and they're 11, 8, 6, and 4 years old. So we're still trying to teach them these things. And you know, in our house, it's crazy and kids are kids and they fight and they take each other's stuff and they make messes and they get in trouble. And we're trying to figure out how do we like have them take ownership, take responsibility, confess their sins, ask for forgiveness, all that kind of stuff. But I think many times the way my kids respond to my wife and I and encourage them to be people of confession and to ask for forgiveness is kind of how we sound before God. Where my kids would be like, I didn't mean to. It was just a mistake. It wasn't my fault. He made me do it. She started it. I didn't make the mess. It wasn't me. Like, or that's not my part of the room. He should clean it up because that's his stuff. And then once we were like, I don't care whose stuff it is. You responded. You did this. Take ownership of it. And we asked them to like try to reconcile and seek forgiveness and say, hey, will you say you're sorry? They'll say something like, I'm sorry. And then they'll be like, can I go play now? And you're just like, you're not feeling the weight of it here, kid. I think sometimes that's how we come before God. We just want to quickly like, sorry, I sinned. Yeah. And just move on. Give me this. Do this. Can I go play now? Sin's a big deal. Daniel knew this. And so he confessed it. I mean, think about some of these words he uses. He says, we have sinned. We have done wrong. We have rebelled. We have scorned your commands and your regulations. We have refused to listen. I just think back of a particular incident in my childhood and teenage years that really I think I and maybe we look like this a lot. When I believe I was 13 years old, my dad introduced me to the BB gun. And I thought the BB gun was awesome because he showed me, you know, here's where you put the BBs and you cock it and you aim at something and boom, you shoot. And whatever you shoot, like, bing, and it can break stuff. I was like, this is awesome. You know, for a teenager, it's like something I can shoot that's not like a real gun, but it's kind of like a gun that's going to break stuff. Awesome. And my dad and my mom gave different rules around the BB gun. Like, when we're not home, you can't use a BB gun and all that kind of stuff. You don't shoot things you're not supposed to shoot. It's like, okay. Well, one particular day, my parents were leaving and they're going to be gone for a little bit. And I think I'd recently just started like really enjoying the BB gun. I was going around shooting stuff. And my mom and dad said, hey, Brandon, we're going to be gone. We'll be back in just a little bit. Do not use the BB gun. No BB gun. I was like, okay, fine. No BB gun. Well, telling a kid not to do something, it's like telling, hey, don't touch the stove, it's hot. It's like, tsh! Like at the moment they left, I like grabbed my BB gun. We had like a little ice cream bucket pail, kind of like this, full of BBs. And I remember just going, grabbing BBs, starting to load the BB gun, and just starting to go around the yard and shooting trees, shooting some bushes, shooting the ground. And then I came upon the biggest, most marvelous target I'd ever seen. My next door neighbor's windows. And I knew I shouldn't. Man, I'll never forget taking that, firing, and hits the glass. You got that spidering kind of effect. It's like, It's like, oh, it's beautiful. So I'm getting more BBs. I'm getting there. And I just start lighting up my neighbor, Mr. Cahey, his windows. He wasn't there. And I'm probably shooting at these things for like 15 minutes. Don't know why. I'm an idiot. I get it. And I get done. I go, put the BB gun back up, go inside, act like nothing happened. Mom and dad get home about 30 minutes later. And I'm just downstairs. I'm not even thinking about it. And all of a sudden, there's a knock at the door. And it was our other neighbor. Her name was Agnes. And I'm in the basement. My bedroom is in the basement. I could hear above the stairwell. I could hear her talking to my parents and saying, hey, you might need to talk to your son. Because I watched him pretty much shoot out all of Mr. Cahey's windows. And I had this moment of dread. Like, how dare Agnes tattle on me? And so I heard my mom and dad go outside. I'm sure they went to go look at the windows. They came back inside and they started to come downstairs. And I'm just freaking out. What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? And my mom and dad come to me and they said, so how was your time while we were gone? Good. Good. What'd you do? Nothing. Just kind of hung out here. Play some video games. Not much. Oh. Hey, did you use the BB gun at all? No. No. No, you told me not to. Didn't use the BB gun. Oh. Okay, that's interesting. Why? Well, you know, are you sure? You sure didn't use the BB gun? Like, you want to tell me anything? No, I didn't. Well, Agnes just came over here and said she saw you using the BB gun. Agnes is a liar. She must be mistaken. I mean, well, hold on. I went, I grabbed the BB gun. I just held it. I was just trying to use it. But I mean, she probably just saw me holding it. No, actually, she said she saw you shooting it. Oh, did she? Okay, what? Do you know why Mr. Cahey's windows are all blown away? No. I mean, I'm lying through my teeth. And then I start putting on this like Oscar-worthy presentation. Like, oh, I really didn't do it. I promise. And my dad finally just cut into it. He's like, son, stop lying. You shot out the windows, own it, confess it, say it, and stop lying about it. Yeah, I did. See, I think we see in Daniel's heart and his prayer here, he's not afraid to say we shot out windows with a BB gun. We did some really stupid stuff. We shouldn't have, God. We missed the mark. I'm ashamed about that. And I think too many of us are him-hauling around, justifying, minimizing, blaming, not really wanting to look God in the face and say, yeah, I did it. You know, like, I shot out the windows. God, I actually used words that were really destructive to somebody. God, I looked at images on the computer that really were just laced with lust and I shouldn't. I use my money very selfishly and I'm greedy and I'm not generous. I dishonored my parents and I ridiculed them and made their life just really difficult. I stole from the company or whatever the case may be, right? Like, we just need to say, I shot out. And Daniel was very honest. He's very forthright. And he was very honest in saying, listen, my face and our faces are covered in shame. And I think some of us, as I mentioned earlier, we elude confession because we don't want to feel shame. And the other thing we don't want to have to do is to repent. And these words, shame and repentance, have become like naughty curse words in our culture today. But they are beautiful, biblical, God-inspired words that we need to embrace. In our culture today, shame is seen like something that no one should ever have any shame. And I would tell you, I believe that shame is not supposed to mark us, but shame is something I believe God will give us to turn to him so we might repent. Shame is only bad when you take what shame does and you label yourself and you make yourself marked by the action. But shame can, it's okay to feel not okay. It's okay to feel like I did something stupid. It's okay to feel bad when you've done something. There are things you should be ashamed of. You should be ashamed when you've been dishonest. You should be ashamed when you've cheated. You should be ashamed when you've done things you shouldn't do. Like, that's okay. And the shame then is when we know we've missed the mark and then we come before a holy, awesome God who's also faithful and forgiving and we come and we say, I have this shame, but I need you to take it from me. And when God takes away the shame, it doesn't become a label to you, but instead you embrace Christ's label upon you, shame's okay. My face is covered with shame. We're full of shame. That's not a bad thing, because it perpetuates us into repent. And to repent means to turn in a different direction, to change your mind. To say, God, over the last 70 years, and even before that, our people have been unbelievably obstinate and disobedient to you. We've not followed the way you've called us to live. And Daniel says, we're sorry. And those words of surrender, of I'm sorry, are just like beautiful things to God's ears. And he comes, and that's when he gets on his knees and says, come, now we can start doing some business. Now we can start making some progress. I will love you and I will forgive you. I will cleanse you. But I can't if you actually don't actually own up to what you've done. Come to me. Repent. Turn. Change your mind. Live differently. So Daniel has an awareness of the awesome and greatness of God, how God is also with that, loving and faithful. It brings him to confession. And then we finally then see supplication. Daniel doesn't make any supplication, which is essentially like this earnest plea in a humble fashion, begging for something. He doesn't make any request to God before first having awareness of who God is and recognizing his place before God. And then he says, oh God, would you please be faithful to your promises? Will you please be faithful to your promises? You see, when our heart sees God in the right way and we are honest about ourselves, recognizing that we don't have it all figured out, that we actually have missed the mark, which is what the word sin means, and that we are in need of help. Once we get through all of that, it puts us in a place saying, at this point, now I am fully weak, fully dependent, and I want what you would give, which is your best, and I will make my petition before you now, God. And what Daniel asks for is for God to fulfill the promise that he read about right there in Jeremiah 29. Would you forgive us? Would you have mercy on us? And God, would you restore us? And will you make good on your word? Take us home. But I think it's important to see that Daniel's supplication before God, his request to God, what he asked of God, by this point now, because he has an awareness of God and he's confessed to God, his supplication is in alignment with God's heart and will. It's not arbitrary. It's not, hey, can you give me a job? Can you give me a girlfriend? Hey, can you help me get through traffic today? You know, whatever it might be. He's asking God things that God said, I've promised to give you. And ultimately, these things that God promises to give us are elements that shape us more into the likeness of who God wants us to be. When you pray, and you make supplications before God, when you earnestly come to God and you cry out to him in a humble fashion, what are you asking for? And are they in alignment with what God has promised I will give to you? I mean, are you aware that there are over 7,000 promises in the scriptures that God makes? 7,000 promises over that God makes from himself to humankind. And what would it look like if we began to be prayerful people that began to pray to God, asking God to fulfill the promises he's already made in our lives rather than asking God to do what we want him to do in our lives? Because I think that's what James was getting at in the book of James, chapter 4, verses 2 and 3. He says, you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it. But he says, and even though when you do ask, you don't get it because your motives are all wrong. All you want is what's going to give you pleasure. Many times we miss the heart of God because we're only asking God for the things that we think are going to make us have pleasure. But God says, you will find pleasure when you actually ask me for the things I've promised to give you, and those provide the pleasure to you. And so when you think of these 7,000 plus promises, they include some of these things. When you pray, when I pray, when we have our supplications presented before God, we need to pray around God's promises. God promises to provide his presence, that his witness is with us, that we'd be aware of his presence. God, would you help me aware of your witness today, his faithfulness, that he will not leave us nor forsake us. God, help us not believe that you're absent, but that you are right here because you've promised that you're right here. You are faithful. God's promise, his kindness and his compassion to us. Help us have eyes to see where you're being kind and where your compassion lies. Help our heart beat with your heart and be kind and compassionate with those around us. Give that person kindness and compassion because you promised to bestow that upon people. God, give us patience. You promised that you would be patient. You've said that you are so patient that you'd want none to perish, but all to come to everlasting life. And so you're patient. So would you give me your patience today in my own life, with patience with the people around me, patience, whatever it might be. You've promised that. You've promised to be a God of forgiveness, that if I confess my sins to you, you are faithful and just, and you will forgive me of all unrighteousness. So will you forgive me, God? And I claim that promise and I say yes in it in Jesus. God, you've promised to help me and to protect me. God, would you help me today see the way that you are helping, the way that you are protecting? God, today I am praying for wisdom. You say if anyone lacks wisdom, to come and ask you for it. I need some wisdom. That's one of the distinguishable qualities, even shine in Babylon. Lord, please give me intellect. Give me wisdom. Give me insight of how to live today, the decisions to make. God, you've promised joy. You've promised peace. You've promised hope. You've promised an anchoring and security, right? That my sins are separated from me as far as the east is from the west. Help me not identify myself and let shame heap upon me to the point that I am labeled now thinking I'm less than, but let me come to Christ and say that you have lifted me up. And I'm not defined by my sin, but I'm defined by my Savior. Lord, give me, help me see the fulfillment of the promises you've made. And when I begin to cry out God's promises, they shape me into who God wants me to be. And it helps me endure whatever happens around me. This is Daniel's prayer. And I love the fact that Daniel in verse 18 has this entire prayer just undergirded. And this one line is so powerful. In verse 18, it's just undergirded with humility. So I'm not asking this because this is what we deserve. But I'm asking you because your great mercy. There's something so magnificent and powerful when we come to a magnificent and powerful God who we know is also loving and faithful. We acknowledge where we've missed the mark. We don't excuse or rationalize or justify or blame shift our sin, but we take responsibility for it. And we even take responsibility when other Christians, I might not have done it, but he says we, the whole nation, but we all collectively know that we need God, and so we come to God. And then we start to make supplications, and we say, God, I know your promises about formation of who you want me to become. Lord, please make me into that person or help others around me become that person as well. This is what it means to be marked with prayerfulness and to have that humility and to know it's not because we deserve it, but ultimately it's because God is great. He deserves us to represent him well. So let me close with this. How did God respond to Daniel's prayer? This is what's so awesome. Hang with me. This is so awesome. You keep reading in verse 21 and through 23. This is what happens. After Daniel gets up, he's praying. It says this. He says, as I was praying, Gabriel, which is one of God's like primary angels, shows up. I mean, I haven't had that happen. I think that'd be awesome. You had that happen, you know, let us know. But he says, I was praying, Gabriel, whom I had seen earlier in a vision, came to me swiftly at the time of the evening sacrifice, and he explained to me, Daniel, I have come here to give you insight and understanding. The moment you began praying, a command was given. Because when you pray in God's will, he's like, boom, absolutely. So the moment you start praying, you saw what had been promised in Jeremiah. You claimed it. You cried out for it. And God said, hey, Gabriel, go and tell Daniel, I'm about to do this. The moment you began praying, a command was given. And now I'm here to tell you what it was. For you are very precious to God. You, not just Daniel, you are very precious to God. He cares and he hears you and he loves you. So listen carefully so that you may understand the meaning of your vision. If you keep reading the end of chapter 9, the way in which God answers Daniel's prayer as he gives him this vision of the anointed one. And the anointed one to come is Jesus. The answer to Daniel's prayer and crying out is Jesus. That was in the Old Testament. When Jesus came on the scene, the answer to people's prayers became Jesus. Jesus is died, resurrected, ascended to heaven. We wait for his return. So the prayers we pray today, I promise you, the most resounding answer to your prayers that God will give is Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, it says this, "For all of God's promises have been fulfilled in Christ with a resounding yes. And through Christ, our amen," which means yes, "ascends to God for his glory." When you and I pray, and we are a people of prayerfulness, make no mistake about it, many of the answers in prayer that we seek have already been given an astounding and resounding yes in Jesus. For Daniel, who wants to go home, well, he's going to go to Jerusalem, but ultimately the greatest home, you have a heavenly kingdom that's about to happen. You're wanting to have this sense of peace and forgiveness, that's going to happen because the anointed one is going to die on the cross to give you and everyone the way of forgiveness forever, and he will raise victoriously from the dead, snatch death away, and give you life. Jesus is the answers to our prayers. I want to ask a couple questions and we'll finish with those questions. Are you a person marked by prayerfulness? How do you see God when you pray to him? Like, what's your awareness of God when you pray to him? How realistic do you see yourself in light of who God is? Do you spend time genuinely confessing your sins to God? What types of requests and supplications do you make to God? And wrestle with this one. How might Jesus already be the answer to the prayers that you're praying to God? As we wrestle with those questions and we find ourselves on our knees and we're a people marked with prayerfulness, it's going to spur on us becoming more filled with integrity. It's going to help us have wisdom. It's going to give us kind of the intestinal fortitude to persevere and to be faithful people. And I believe the combination of those four will help us shine bright in our current Babylon. And make no mistake about it, it will shine. And the world, I believe, will want to know how, why, where's it come from? And we point to Jesus. I want to thank you for hanging out throughout the series, hanging out with us here today. Next week, we're going to kick off a brand new series called The Third Person, where we're really going to just dive in to the third person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit. It's going to be an awesome series, so make sure to be a part of that. Can't wait to kick that off. But don't jump too far ahead. Let's land here today and consider the last month of how we can be a people marked with integrity, wisdom, faithfulness, and prayerfulness. If we can connect with you in any way, we would love to do that. Please just text the word CARE, C-A-R-E, to 484848. A form will be sent to your phone. Fill that out, submit it, and we will have someone get in touch with you right away to set up a time to connect. And we are just so grateful for you, grateful for your heart. I'm excited to see what God's going to keep doing in us, through us, and around us. So between now and when we kick off a new series next week, as always, may we be a people who wake up, rise, and shine. May we wake up to Jesus, rise to life in him, and shine to others for him. We're going to shine in our Babylon. God bless you. See you next week.